Welcome to Bibliophiles Anonymous, episode 23. I'm Denise.
And I'm Jess.
And today on this episode, we are going to talk about our favorite book covers. I know that a lot of times that's part of what draws me to pick up a book and to find it interesting. So that's one of the things we're going to talk about today.
Yep.
And we have a bunch of them, I think.
Yeah, I have a list.
I have a very small list.
I actually went and looked at my bookshelf and looked for the ones that the covers I really liked. I'm like, so, yeah, I have a list.
Yeah. Well, there's several of them for me. Sometimes it's hard for me to remember. And now especially I have so many books on my Kindle that you kind of lose that a little bit. That's one of the things I don't like about ebooks. I mean, there's a lot of things I like about ebooks, but not having the cover, you could still see the cover, but it's not the same.
No, it's not.
No. But before we talk about that, let's talk about what we're reading right now.
I'm still stuck on Beautiful Creatures, but
okay. Seriously, you've got to work on that one.
No, wait, it's not that it's not good. It's really good, and I want to finish it, but I don't like admitting this, but I got sucked into America's Next Top Model again.
Oh, geez.
Oxygen shows an entire cycle in one day sometimes. And that's like my guilty pleasure show. That is my guilty pleasure. I don't like admitting that I watch it, but I do.
We all have them. It's okay.
So I've got sucked into that. I watched an entire cycle yesterday. I didn't even get on Lord of the Rings Online yesterday because I was watching America's Next Top Model.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, you have a problem.
I do.
Because that's distracting you from your other problem, which is Lord of the Rings Online.
Yeah, which is what originally is distracting me from my reading.
Yeah. Well,
I've
been wanting to read Beautiful Creatures, too. So I'm going to track it down, and we're going to read it and review it on the podcast. That's going to make you have to finish it.
Yes, I really need to do this because I really need to start reading Rhapsody.
Yes, because that is the next Tavern Book Club book.
And it's been so long since I read it that I really do need to read it again if I'm going to, even remotely sound like I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that would be good.
So I've got to finish Beautiful Creatures so I could, I don't have to because this is me and I read, six books at a time anyway, but I'm really trying to do better about that.
Well, in case anybody wants to read Rhapsody with us over at the Tavern, that book club is starting on the 15th of March. Gosh, it's almost March already. That's so weird.
Yeah.
Actually, by the time the podcast is up, it will be March. Oy. Anyway, so it'll start on the 15th, and that is Rhapsody by Elizabeth Hayden.
Yes.
So
and you might want to go ahead and start on it because it's 650 pages long.
Yeah.
So it's a hefty.
Yeah, I've got it. I'm actually going to probably start reading it this weekend. So, yeah, that'll be fun. Let's see. As far as I've been doing, I finished reading Lyrial by Garth Nix. Really, really good. Really good. I guess, like I said before, I liked it even better than Sabriel. And I liked Sabriel a lot. So, I finished Lyrial.
That one too.
Yeah, I finished Lyrial and I started the third book, Abhorson. And so far it's just like off and running, almost literally. It's a roller coaster just at the beginning, and I've only read the first couple of chapters. So I'm enjoying that. I also wanted to mention, because this was a book that I had mentioned a while ago on the podcast, I'd mentioned that I read The Perks of Being a Wallflower by Stephen Chbosky.
Mm-hmm.
I finally saw the movie.
Ah, how was it?
It was really good. And a couple of things I didn't know, because I got an email saying that it was available at Redbox. So it's now in Redbox, anybody who goes to Redbox. And I didn't realize that Stephen Chbosky wrote the screenplay and directed it.
Ah, well, that'll definitely help keep it true to the book.
Well, the other thing, too, is that the book is only, 200 pages. It's a little book. It's not like these Harry Potter books that are 700 pages long that you have to slaughter in order to make it fit. They could pretty much do everything with this, but it was so good. Hearing about the movie was the main reason I read the book in the first place.
Right.
And I only really heard about the movie because Emma Watson was in it. And I just think that she's adorable. So, and plus, being one of the Harry Potter kids and watching her grow up, it's like, you know, you kind of want to keep an eye on them and see what they're doing now that now that Harry Potter's over. So I was very impressed with her, actually. She was really good. As different from Hermione Granger as you could possibly be. So that was, it was really funny to see her like that, because it's so different from what you would expect, because you're used to seeing her in that one character.
Right.
But no, it was really, really good. And this is the best compliment that I can give it, because I really liked this book, and it really made me feel something, you know? Yeah. And I love it when books do that, when they really can, like, touch you that way. And I had the same feelings after watching the movie. So it still captured that same feeling. So go see it. It's good.
Yeah, it's really good. You know, like really well I said, done. The person writing the book, also writing the screenplay and directing the movie, would tend to help keep things the way they're supposed to be.
Yeah, they're not going to go too crazy. I mean, there were some things that they left out, obviously, but it was really neat. And it was difficult, I would think, because the entire book is written like in a series of letters. I mean, there's no like regular straight prose. It's all letters written by this, you know, young kid named Charlie.
Yeah.
And he's talking about his life, but you would think that style would be hard to translate into a movie, but it worked. It was really good. Anyway, I'll stop now. It was really good. Okay. So, today we're going to talk about book covers. And I actually got this idea after seeing a news article that was talking about the Harry Potter books, speaking of Harry Potter, that they are coming out with all new book covers for the 15th anniversary of Sorcerer's Stone.
15? That's not possible.
15 years. Yep, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. It was published in September of 1998, according to this article. So, yep.
Okay.
Just accept it.
But they can't... I don't like them doing all new covers, because then I'll want to buy them all.
Well, they've released the cover art for the first one, and it's really pretty, actually. Let me see if I can send it to you on Skype. Well, I would. My Skype didn't go away. Oh, well. I'll send it to you later. But
well, you know, Harry Potter, it's on my list anyway.
Yes. Well, we can start there. Let's go ahead and start there. Because, you know, they're pretty amazing.
Yeah, I mean, I love the U.S. covers. I really do. They're colorful. They're pretty. I love the style of them. But my favorite Harry Potter covers are the UK adult covers. I think it's Bloomsbury is the one that published them. And I saw them when Peregrine from the Tavern was visiting me several years ago. He had brought his copies with him to the States, which he ended up buying an entire set of the US ones that were out at the time to take back to Australia with him. And that's where I first saw them. And then we looked up the cover for Half-Blood Prince, because that one was about to come out when he was here, I believe. Because he was here in March, and I believe that one came out in July, August, something. But we had looked up the cover, and the cover is just, they're actual photos. They're not art.
Uh-huh.
And it was a photo of an old, worn-out copy of Advanced Potions Making. And all of the books were like that, and I thought those were really neat. I really, really like those covers, and I've been trying to find a way to acquire a set of these ever since then. Just hasn't worked very well.
Yeah, I'm looking at a couple of them on Goodreads. They have the different book covers there, and like the one for Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, because that's what they call it over there, it's actually a picture of the Philosopher's Stone. Like you said, it's more like a photograph than like artwork, like a drawing image. And it looks like it's a reddish stone that almost looks like it's glowing from the inside, so that's kind of pretty.
Yeah, I really, really like those covers. And I blame Peregrine.
It's all his fault.
Or I probably would have never realized what they looked like.
Mm-hmm.
I tried to steal them when he was here, but he wasn't having any of that.
Yeah, I can't blame him. Well, the new cover, like I said, they only have the one out for Sorcerer's Stone, but they have the artist that's drawing them, and I am not even going to try to pronounce his name because I would butcher it. okay, I'll try it. It's Kazu Kibushi? I don't know. But he's the author or the artist for a series of graphic novels.
Ah.
So he's also a major Harry Potter fan, which I think is kind of nice. But his vision for it was to find a distinct and memorable moment from each book and try to draw something that would encapsulate that. And for Sorcerer's Stone, it's the scene the first time that Harry walks into Diagon Alley with Hagrid.
Mm.
So, you know, you have all of the crazy buildings. You have Harry kind of looking around like, whoa, and Hagrid right behind him and all of the witches and wizards kind of along the sides of the streets in their different robes and hats and yeah. Hedwig and in the background there. So it's just, it looks really pretty, actually. But yeah, I've always loved the Harry Potter book covers, and it was always fun, especially towards the end of the series, when it was such a big deal that they were revealing the next book cover. I remember, especially with Deathly Hallows, they had it was on all the morning talk shows where they always had it underneath a drop cloth, and they pulled it off. And it was like, yeah. Oh, there it is. So, no, I love all the Harry Potter covers. I think probably my favorite one. I don't know what all of the international ones look like, so I just have the regular American versions.
The Scholastic covers.
Yeah, but I always really, really liked Order of the Phoenix.
Yeah.
With the blue with all of the candles from when they're in the ministry. Yeah. And I think I liked that one, too, because it was the first one, really, that you could see that Harry was growing up. And
yeah.
That was kind of where he started really getting a lot more responsibility was in that book, at the end of that book especially. So, and you could just tell that from the cover art. Because he looked a lot older than he did on the Goblet of Fire cover. And even though it was only supposed to be 1 year, you could tell that it was more than a year, you know, emotionally, mentally, because of all the stuff he went through. And I think that the cover kind of related that.
Yeah, well, see, you know, they do new Harry Potter covers. I'm going to want to buy a new set of the books, because that's just how things work with me. They're new and they're pretty and I'm going to want them, but I'm not going to want to get rid of my old ones. I'm going to want to keep them.
Yeah.
Because I have a complete set that matches.
Yeah, see, that's my thing. I don't have a complete set of Harry Potter books that match, but my husband does. So I can pretend that mine are all nice and pretty because he hasn't really touched his very much. He doesn't read books over and over and over like I do. So, you know, his Goblet of Fire is all in one piece. Unlike mine, which I think is now in three separate pieces. It was really hard on that book.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I don't want to replace it. Because
it's sentimental value.
I have, you know, feelings for that book. But anyway, so let's talk about some different books. Which other ones are on your list?
Well, you know, you just finished reading these, but the Chicagoland Vampires books.
Yes, those are good.
I think the covers are part of what made me fall in love with the books so hard.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, on each cover, you've got Merritt looking like a badass.
Pretty much.
And she's actually, they're doing something different with the new one,
mm-hmm.
Biting Bad. She's crouched down, and every one of the others, she's been standing.
Yes.
But she's going to be crouched down on Biting Bad, so that's going to be, you know, a little bit different. But I love the covers. They're colorful, and, you know, they have Merritt on them looking like a badass.
Well, they're colorful, but they're also, they have, like, a darkness to them.
Yeah, they are. They're dark, and
There's usually one overarching color, like, for, like,
yeah.
Well, House Rules is, there's a lot of red. And
yes. Well, some girls bought, there was a lot of pink.
Yeah. And then you had a lot of orange and a lot of green and a lot of blue. Biting Bad's got purple, yeah. So I'm happy about that.
Yeah, well, you know, I am too. Purple's my favorite color. But
I like purple.
You know, those covers were really, really awesome, and I think that's part of what, I mean, I saw the cover. I don't even remember. I think it was recommended to me on Amazon, I believe. I was looking through my recommendations, and I saw it, and I was like, this cover looks really cool. And I got the preview, and I read it, and I was, you know, sucked into the world of Ethan and Merritt. So, those are definitely on my list of favorite covers. And then I also, this is another one, we actually read the first book and discussed it on the podcast a while back.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the Seven Realms series by Cinda Williams-Chima.
Oh, yes.
And these covers, particularly the cover of The Grey Wolf Throne and The Crimson Crown, are so pretty. And they're especially pretty if you line them all up next to each other and kind of look at them together. It's just like, they're so pretty. And they really are, because, I mean, the first one is kind of a greenish color.
Right, because you have the amulet in the middle.
Right. And I don't remember what color the second one is. The third one is purple. The Grey Wolf Throne is purple. And the Crimson Crown is crimson.
The second one is kind of blue, but it has a big gold ring in the middle.
Yeah.
It's mostly
those
blue.
Are so pretty. And I think when I did my blog, my review on the tavern, on my tavern blog, I actually linked all of the covers, and because they look really good together.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of those, too, that I think the cover had a lot to do with me picking it up and buying it when I found it in Barnes & Noble, I think.
Uh-huh.
That I saw the cover, and I was like, wow, this cover's kind of cool. And I read the blurb, and I'm like, I'll buy it. And then, you know, it took me 2 years to read it. But when I read it, I loved it and read the entire series and really, 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 really liked it. So, you know, eventually I will buy the rest of them when they're in paperback and I can get them. So, but yeah, those are the main ones I have to rave about, because I remember thinking, not so much with the first one because I'm, you know, not a huge fan of green. But when I saw all four of them and actually, you know, put them next to each other, I'm like, wow, these are actually really, really pretty covers.
They are. I'm looking at your blog post now to see them all lined up like that. Yeah, they do look really nice together. And it's not just, they're all similar because you have this kind of mountainous background and then one, like, major object that's, like, right in the middle. It's a focal point. Like, the first one, it's the amulet. And the second one, it's a ring that's on a chain. The third one is a crown. And then the fourth one looks like it's some kind of necklace of some sort. But so you have these big images, and then you have this kind of softer background. But then I like how they did the names, the author's name, and then the title. Because it's not, it's sideways.
Yeah, they're parallel with the spine of the book.
Yeah, which usually it's, you know, it's not like that.
No, so, usually, you know, it's up at top and down at the bottom.
Yeah, but this one it's side to side.
These are on the left side. These are kind of in the margins.
Yeah. So it makes them look very different, very distinctive.
Yeah, they are. They stand out.
Yeah.
Which her other books are like that, too. The Air, Warrior Air. I don't remember the name of the series, but the first book was The Warrior Air. And the author's name and title are, you know, vertical like that on those two.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, apparently it's her thing.
She likes that.
Or, you know, her publisher likes that, because a lot of times the author doesn't have much to say about the covers.
Yeah, that's true.
That's usually a publisher thing.
Well, let's move on to another one that I know both of us had on our list, and that is the covers for the Mortal Instruments series by Cassandra Clare.
Yes. They're shiny.
They are shiny. They have kind of a metallic sheen to it. And, you know, we're not just saying that we like them because the first book happens to have a shirtless Jace on the cover.
That's not relevant.
That has nothing to do with it whatsoever. But the thing is, I love these covers, and I always have, because it has, they take place in New York City or Brooklyn or one of the boroughs. they move around a lot. But each one has like a cityscape scene, and then has a person kind of standing above it. But the thing that I always found kind of strange about these is that their whole face isn't there.
Yeah.
It's like the top of the book cuts off their face, and you see like their mouth and their chin, and then nothing above it.
Well, you know, in a way, I kind of like that because it still lets you form your own picture in your mind.
Yeah.
Of what they actually look like.
But the first one has Jace on it. The second one has Clary. The third one...
Third one is Simon, I believe.
I think it is Simon. It's...
Yeah, I remember... I follow Cassandra Clare on Tumblr, and I'm pretty sure she said that the third one was Simon.
Yeah, that's what I always thought it was, and I remember we talked about it when we read City of Bones for the Tavern Book Club, and this was a while back. But, because you were talking about the people on the covers, and I remember, I can't remember if it was you or if it was Marita or who it was, but somebody was saying that Simon was just going to be a throwaway character that wasn't going to come up again, that was just there to kind of be Clary's, you know, friend who was a normal human, and then she gets swept up into the Shadowhunter stuff, and, you know, we never see Simon again. And I just kind of chuckled to myself, because at the time I think I was the only person in the tavern who had read these.
Yeah.
And I said, just to let you guys know, you're reading the first book, which has Jace on the cover, and then the second book has Clary, but the third book has Simon. So he's not going anywhere.
No. Simon is round the
ball. He's going to end up being kind of important. So you might want to pay attention to Simon. And that's all I'm going to say. And I just remember somebody was like, well, okay then.
Yeah. I remember when I found out that Simon was on the cover of the third one, I was like, well, he's going to be important. Let's just keep him around.
Yeah.
Which I like Simon, but I'm not in love with Simon like I am with Jace.
I think he's adorable. I'm sorry, but maybe, but it's, I like the, you know, kind of geeky, nerdy boys, so that's just my thing.
I like the bad boys, so.
Yeah, so there you go. That's okay, that means that there's one for each of us. It's all good.
Yes, that means we don't have to fight.
Mm-mm.
Of course, you know, the problem is also that I like Will Herondale.
Well, you're gonna have to choose, because I don't think you can have both.
Sure I can.
She's like, this is fiction. Of course I can.
I was just saying, they're fictional. I can have them both.
And you can throw in an Ethan Sullivan, too, just because.
Yes. And you know, the multitude of others that I have fallen in love with.
Yeah. Well, the next book covers that I wanted to talk about was one, a series that I recently finished and that you said you were going to finish and didn't. And that is the Iron Fae series by Julie Kagawa.
Yeah.
Her book covers are so pretty.
They are. And I think it was the colors that attracted me to them when I saw them in Walmart on the shelf sitting next to each other. I'm like, those colors look really good together, and those look really pretty on my bookshelf.
They are. They are very pretty on the bookshelf. I have all four of them. But the first one... They all are very similar. They have a face, or part of a face, usually either in profile or just, like, showing half of a face. And for the first three, it's Megan's face. She's the main character. The fourth one actually has Ash's face on it.
I love... See, Ash is another one that I loved.
He is... He's... Well, it took me a while to get into him, actually.
Well, yeah, I didn't get into him till, you know, later on in the second book.
But the thing that's neat, so you have the face, and then everything else is just kind of tree branches and vines, because they're going into the fairy realm, so it's going to be all trees and vines and plants and that. But the colors are not just like green or, you know, what you would assume. But the first one is mostly like teal, kind of a turquoisey color. And then the second one is this light lavender. And the third one is a really, really deep pink, like a really dark pink, like a dark rose. And then the fourth one since it's mostly dealing with Ash, and he's the prince of the winter court, it's blue and has more like icicles and snowflakes kind of through it. But the other thing that's neat about the fourth book is that on the cover you have Ash's face, but then on the back you have Puck's face. So, because you kind of have to go back and forth with those characters quite a bit. They're definitely rivals. And you can just kind of tell because they both kind of have that sort of challenging look in their eyes. So, and that was different because she usually didn't have any art on the back of her other books. So, you know, having one boy on one side, one on the other was kind of neat.
Yeah, those were really pretty. I liked the swirly, viney, girly stuff.
Yeah, and that motif kind of continues into the book, too, because they have that same kind of scrolling vine on each of the first pages of each chapter.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. But, yeah, they do look very pretty all lined up on a bookshelf. And I can't wait to get her other series, The Call of the Forgotten, I think. It's dealing with Megan's brother, Ethan. And
the first book in it is kind of a... The color of it is a mix between Ash's book and the first book.
Yeah.
The turquoisey and blue color. It's a dark turquoisey color.
It's very, very, very deep color. Yeah. So, eventually I'll get there.
Molly.
Oh, well, good.
I mean, I've got the fourth and fifth book, fourth book of the Forgotten Realms, and then Iron Fae, whatever the name of the series is. I forget. I got book four from her, and then I got the other book from her because she bought them both, and I was like, I need to read these. I'm taking them home with me. So, you know, hopefully I won't keep her books as long as she keeps mine.
Well, have you read them yet?
Nope. But she kept my Tanya Huff books. And my Mercedes Lackey's Diana Tregard series for, like, 2 years.
Oh, okay. Well, as long as you read them in 2 years, then you should be all right. But you need to read them before then.
Yes, I know.
Uh-huh.
I think I'm just in that funk where I don't really want to read. And when I get out of that, I'm going to devour everything. I don't know. I read so much last year that it's like, I need a break.
Yeah, it's absolutely astonishing to me that I am beating everyone in the tavern reading challenge, and I don't know how that's possible.
Oh, just wait. If I get back into the reading thing,
oh,
which,
I know.
You know, the downside of this is if I get back into the reading, Lord of the Rings is going to fall by the wayside. So you will probably start, you know, you'll be like, you know, 10 levels ahead of me.
You need to strike up a balance between the two.
But
all I can say is that Goodreads says that I am 8 books ahead of schedule, and I'm going to try and stay about that because as the year goes on, life can get absolutely kooky. So I'm going to try and stay ahead of schedule so that I can actually accomplish my goal of reading 70 books this year. So,
another series I would like to talk about,
yes,
the book covers, is The Voyage of the Jarl Shannara Trilogy by Terry Brooks. Now, I love Terry Brooks. I've read almost all of his Shannara books. I haven't read the newest ones, mostly because I don't have them. Well, I have the first two in one of his series. Anyway, I haven't read them yet. But everything prior to that, I've read. And while I cannot read The Sword of Shannara anymore, because when I try, I'm just like, he ripped off Lord of the Rings and I can't read this. Everything after that is really, really good. And my favorite series that he's written is the Voyage of the Jarl Shannara Trilogy. And the Jarl Shannara is an airship. I mean, these are fantasy novels. They're set, you know, in a typical fantasy, you know, high fantasy setting. But they've got airships, which is cool. And the covers of these books, especially the first one, the hardcover especially, is really, really pretty. Because, like, the cover actually has, like, the hardcover has a picture printed on it, and then the dust jacket is, like, cellophane, and you can kind of see through it, and it's so pretty. It's really, really cool. I mean, I've got the paperbacks, and the paperback is pretty, too, but the hardback is just really, really cool. because of that. Because it's something you don't see. Usually the dust jacket is just printed on paper.
Right.
And wrapped around a plain black or colored cardboard.
Right.
But this one, they actually printed something on the actual book and then did this cellophane dust jacket that's, it's not really, it's translucent and it has sort of a pearlescent sheen to it. It was just really, really, really pretty.
Now, I'm looking it up on Goodreads. Is this the one that looks like it has some kind of fountain and there's a hawk in the middle?
It's kind of green and white. The name of it is Ilswitch.
Yeah, that's the one I'm looking at.
Yeah.
But it has a hawk in the middle of it?
Yeah.
Okay, that's the one I'm looking at.
But I just thought the hardcover was really, really pretty. I mean, then the other two books in the series are really pretty, too. The second one is kind of a orangey color, like a bright orange.
Uh-huh.
And I don't remember. The third one is kind of a, like a not quite as bright orange, I think, or tan or something. Anyway, all three covers are really, really pretty. But it was the first one in the series, Ilswitch. That was just, it was just really, really cool because, like I said, the dust jacket, they did something different than most hardback books. You know, it wasn't just a paper dust jacket. It was really neat the way that it layered together. It made it look almost 3D, kind of.
Right.
It was really neat. I really, really like those. And those are really, really good. And if you've tried to read the people out there, I've known a lot of people who tried to read The Sword of Shannara, and it was just way too derivative of Lord of the Rings, and they gave up. They couldn't read it. Don't start there. The Voyage of the Drell Shannara trilogy, because that series is really, 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 really good. And you don't really have to have read the others to get those.
Okay.
So don't give up on Terry Brooks just because The Sword of the Shannara is not great. Whereas if you've never read Lord of the Rings, then go ahead and read The Sword of the Shannara because it probably won't bother you. But for those of us that have, it's too painful. I can't do it. Which, you know, talking about Lord of the Rings reminds me, there is a specific set of covers of Lord of the Rings. There's only, 4 million different covers for these books?
There are a lot.
I have a set that is older than I am. It's my parents' set that they had, you know, when I was a little bitty something. And these books, the covers are a solid color. There's a, see, the first one is green. No, the first one is blue, the second one is green, and the third one is red. Just solid covers, has a title on it, but there's this square image on the cover, just a perfect square. And the art is by Daryl K. Sweet. And these pictures are awesome. The cover of Fellowship of the Ring is the party out, or no. Yes. It's the party outside the gates of Moria.
Uh-huh.
And it's showing the door glowing blue and Gandalf and the hobbits and everybody around the door, and it's really cool. And the second one is the hobbits. They're standing, I think it's Sam and Frodo and Gollum. And they're standing by this statue that's had its head knocked off. And then the third one is, I believe it's Aragorn and Gandalf. So, I mean, I guess it's because that was the set my parents had when I was younger, and that was the first set that I read.
Uh-huh.
I really, really, really like those covers. My set is falling apart. You broke Harry Potter, I broke Lord of the Rings. Actually, those are not so bad. The copy of The Hobbit that goes with those, which is gold and has them standing in the eagle's nest with one of the eagles.
Huh.
And the copyright page says that the cover art is Bilbo Arrives at the Docks of the Elves by J.R.R. Tolkien. My copyright page is wrong. Because that's not what's on the cover of that book. Because I'm pretty sure the cover art that's on that one is the same artist that did the other three because the style matches. It's very similar.
Right.
I do have one that has cover art by Tolkien on it. It's Bilbo riding the barrels down the river. But my copy of The Hobbit, I never knew that, but my copy of The Hobbit, the copyright page is wrong about the cover art. It's also broken and in three pieces. So.
I understand. I understand that I've been there.
But yeah, I really like. I guess that's kind of a sentimental thing why I love those so much, because like I said, that was the first set that I read. That was the set my parents had. Actually, that was my parents' second set. They broke a set before they got that one. So I come by my love of Lord of the Rings, honestly.
Yeah, obviously. Well, one that I wanted to talk about, it's the third book in a trilogy, but the book was so massive that it's actually in two parts. And the trilogy is Memory, Sorrow, and Thorn by Tad Williams. And the other two books are, they're perfectly nice covers, but I fell in love with the book's covers. The book three is two parts, and I was trying to find out how many pages it is. I'm looking at it here. It's part one is 796 pages, and part two is likewise huge. Neither one of the other books are anywhere near this size, but these two are big, and I don't know why they didn't just have it be a four-part series and, you know, that's it. But the last book, it's called To Green Angel Tower.
Yeah, I've seen it.
Yeah, and it's funny because I actually knew somebody who was reading these and had found this book, actually part one, and read it, not knowing that there was a whole other two books before it. And I saw her reading them, and I loved, you know, the book cover. And I wanted to read it, and so I borrowed it and tried to read it, and I was so completely lost. And that's when both of us found out that there were books ahead of this, because I was like, there has to be more than this, because this doesn't make any sense. And she's like, I know, but it's so pretty. Okay. So we had to go back and figure out what was going on. Oh, now it makes sense. But both books are very similar, of part one and part two of To Green Angel Tower. You have two people who are up on a cliff, a man and a woman. One is standing and the other is kind of crouched down or kneeling. And they are overlooking the buildings of a city. And in the first one, you have these people, they're called the Sithi, and they're basically elves for the most part. And you can tell there's a difference because the book one has elves and book two has humans on the cover. And then the cities that they're overlooking are, one is the Sithi's city and one is the human city. And just seeing it off in the distance with all of the buildings, and then part two actually has Green Angel Tower in it because, you know, it should, since that's the name of the book. Yeah. But they're really, really beautiful. And if you set them, they look really pretty sitting next to each other. But it's funny because the cover of part one is the back of part two and vice versa. So they can be identical if you flip them over. But this was a really good series too. It's hefty. It's really long.
Yeah, I've seen those. I think I have a friend that did the same thing. She bought part one and didn't realize that, you know, there were other books before it until she started reading it.
Well, see, because the problem is that it says up at the top in really big letters that takes up, like, you know, almost half of the book cover. It has Tad Williams and then the name of the book. And then right under it, it says part one. And then in tiny letters along the bottom, it says book three of Memory, Sorrow, and Thorn. So really, when you pick it up, and if you're holding it at the bottom, your fingers are going to completely cover the other part. You're going to look at it and say, oh, well, this is part one. No, it's not. It's actually book three, part one. But you won't notice that because book three is written in tiny letters, and it's also on top of a whole bunch of other, like, really intricate stuff, so you can completely miss it.
Yeah, well, you know, that's kind of misleading on the publisher's part.
It's slightly.
Of course, you know, really, it's not a bad marketing idea. If you think about it, that people will pick up book three because the cover looks interesting and get it and be like, wait, there's more books. So then they'll go buy book one and two.
We have to go get the first stuff because it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. I mean, you can still enjoy the story, but it just takes you a while to really sort out who's who.
Yeah.
But it's a really good series. You said you haven't read it?
No, it's on my to-read list that is longer than my lifespan, but, you know.
Yeah.
And that, oh my gosh, and I cannot remember the artist's name. You were talking about, you know, a book being one book but being in two parts.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of the Raymond Feist books.
Mm-hmm.
The original Rift War series, The Magician and everything. And I love the covers of those books because I love the artist that does them. And I love him, and now I cannot remember the artist's name. It has completely left me. Like, I mean, I have puzzles hanging on my walls of his artwork. Not just his... I actually have a puzzle from that is the picture from the cover of A Darkness at Sethanon.
Uh-huh.
It's Tomas and a dragon, and it's really pretty, and it glows in the dark.
Oh, okay.
But I actually have some of his other artwork that I have found as puzzles and put together and glued, and they're hanging on my walls, and I have completely blanked on the artist's name. He also is the guy that did, that created the Captain Morgan cartoon that is on the Captain Morgan rum bottles.
Oh, really?
And, oh my God, I have completely forgotten his name. Well, anyway, those book covers are really pretty. He's a very, very good fantasy artist.
Uh-huh.
I go on his website and look at his pictures. He's got so many really, really, really pretty pictures. They're very colorful. They're kind of in a realistic style. I mean, the people actually look like people and whatnot.
Right.
And they're just really, really good.
Okay.
His name is Don Mayetz, and he is really, really good. And I think he's done all of the Raymond E. Feist books, but like I said, you made me think of it because most places Magician is published as one book.
Uh-huh.
But in the U.S., Magician is published as two books.
Yeah, we had this discussion when we were getting ready to put it. It's going to be at the Tavern Book Club, and we were trying to decide whether we were going to try and do it as one book or two.
Yeah. Because but my problem is, now that I've thought about it, I looked at my books. One of my books is the, you know, unabridged version. The other one is not. So I'm missing things. One of them is the author's revised edition. So I've got to find a matching pair. But yeah, those covers, like I said, we'll put a link to his website in the description for the episode. Because his art is really good.
Yeah, just send it to me.
And I mean, and he sells prints and stuff on his website. And I got lucky. Walmart for a while was selling like a lot of fantasy puzzles, glow in the dark,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of them were artwork by him. And he is one of my favorite fantasy artists. Like I said, I know two, for sure two of the puzzles I have on my walls are Don Mayetz artwork. I'm pretty sure I have more that I haven't hung up. I know I haven't hung up my Darkness at Sethanon one. But I'm pretty sure I have some smaller ones that I did that were his.
Uh-huh.
But I don't know what happened to him. But he's actually, if you go to his website and start looking, he's actually done a lot of fantasy art that you'll probably recognize. Because like I said, he created Captain Morgan for Captain Morgan Rum. So, but those are really good too. I love those. I need to reread those, too, because I've got some Raymond Feist books that I got that I haven't read, and I need to refresh myself before I read them. I have too much to read.
Yeah, you and me both.
It's like, I need to read this. I need to reread this.
Yeah, I've started just having a big stack of them on my desk, and I'm trying to work it down, but then there's a lot of them that aren't here because I don't actually own them yet, or I need to get them from the library, or... You know, it's a never-ending cycle because I read one and then all of a sudden I find like three more that I want to read, at least.
Exactly. It goes to the stack and it just... Right. One step forward, two steps back.
Pretty much.
You know.
Well, a couple other book covers I just wanted to mention. I'm not going to go into too much detail about them just because sometimes it's almost... I want to say less is more. With book covers, I mean, you can have some of these that are really detailed and these big epic scenes, but sometimes just having something that's simple can be even more effective.
Yeah.
And y'all have heard me talk this book to death because I just really, really liked it that much. But it's Feed by Mira Grant. And Okay, it's about zombies. So it's going to be messy, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the word feed in this book has a double meaning. Because it's, you know, the zombies are eating people. They want to feed. But it's also talking about, like, your news feed. Because they're internet journalists. So you have that double meaning. And the cover is just, looks like a gray concrete background. And then you have the title of the book that looks like, I mean, there's no nice way to say it. It looks like it's written in blood. But there's also the symbol that you have usually for an RSS feed,
mm-hmm.
also written in blood right above it. So it's like this double meaning, almost a pun, a play on words.
Yeah.
Using very, very little.
Yeah, I mean, well, you know, less can be more. Like you said, it's not always about these intricate, detailed pictures.
Right.
I mean, you know, yeah, the Don Matt's pictures that are on the covers of the Remedy Fast books are pretty detailed. They're pretty, you know, there's a lot to them. But it's not always about that. I mean, the Chicagoland Vampires, I mean, yeah, they're, you know, detailed as far as, you know, you see a person, but usually it's just Merritt standing there.
Right.
You know, it's fairly simple. It's not, you know, backgrounds detailed and da-da-da-da. But you're right, simple, less can be more.
Right.
You know, it can be effective without being busy.
One of my favorite books that I read last year was The Fault in Our Stars by John Green, and that one is very simple. It's just a dark teal with white cloud shapes, and that's it. It doesn't, and it even just looking at the book, it doesn't tell you much about what it's about, but just that very simple picture kind of gives a feeling, just kind of gives you not an idea about what the book's about, but kind of the general feeling about it. And that's one, when I first saw the cover art for that one, when they first released it, I was kind of, okay, that's, it took me a while to really appreciate it, but I do now, because especially after reading the book, it was just like, wow, okay, that was a book that just had to be, it's more of an experience than a book. And yeah. But it's so simple, but it still draws you in. And that's something that I can't even imagine how difficult it is to try and design some of these. Because you have so many options to choose from. Do you take a scene from the book and try and depict it? Do you make it very plain and very simple? Do you go for some combination between the two? I couldn't even begin to try. To come up with these ideas.
Well, you know, in a way, I like the ones that do depict a scene from the book. But in a way, I don't. Because if you've got the characters and you see this scene, then it's going to kind of color the way you see the character in your head.
Right.
Or if it doesn't, you're going to read the books and develop your own idea of what they look like. And then when you finish, you're going to look at the cover and you'll be like, no, that's wrong.
Well, and that's part of why I really, really, really don't like when they've done a movie version of the book
and put the and they people
do, they yeah they do a tie-in cover with the movie people or something from the movie on the book cover.
Holly was talking about that the other day. We were in Walmart and they have beautiful creatures at Walmart, and she was going to buy it. She's like, but I don't want the movie cover.
Right.
And it's essentially identical to my copy. I mean, the book cover, this is another one of those that's really simple. I mean, it's a dark colored cover, and there's, like, some shiny silvery trees. I mean, they're not even really trees. It's just sort of, I mean, you can tell they're trees, but they're not real detailed. It's just kind of, and it just says beautiful creatures in metallic purple. It's very simple. And the one at Walmart, the movie cover is essentially the same thing, except instead of trees, below the beautiful creatures logo is the cast.
Yeah, see, I don't like that. And this isn't to say that I don't own some of these books that with these book covers, because every once in a while, it's hard to find the original covers anymore.
Yeah.
I know that, like, my copy of The Perks of Being a Wallflower has the three main actors on the cover. And, you know, that's fine. Whatever. I do have a set of Lord of the Rings paperbacks that have the Lord of the Rings movie people on the cover. Because
see, I do. I have a trade paperback set.
Yeah, and mostly it's because they were really cheap.
And well, see, I actually bought those after I saw the movie, and I bought them because of the movie covers. So that was one, because I bought them more as a keepsake.
Souvenir.
Souvenir than really to read, because I have two other sets and an omnibus. So I really, I've got Lord of the Rings coming out my ears over here.
Yeah, you do.
But those were more I bought because I really liked the way they did the movie covers, and because I had seen the movies and I really liked the movies, and I thought they did a fantastic job casting the movies.
This is true.
So those didn't bother me as bad.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, those didn't bother me as much. It was, but I mostly bought them just because they were cheap, being the mass market paperback. But it was, I think the first one for Fellowship, it just has a picture of Frodo and Sting. And I think Two Towers has a picture of Saruman, I think. And Return of the King obviously has Aragorn.
Yeah.
But I do remember, I think, I'm almost positive I ended up with Two Towers that had Saruman, because then I found out that there was another copy of it that had Legolas on it, and I was like, why couldn't I have gotten the pretty cover?
I think Legolas is on mine.
Why couldn't I, why do I have to have the ugly guy?
My first one has Frodo holding the ring, I believe. Like the scene after they pull it out of the fire and he's holding it and it's glowing on his face.
Oh, okay.
I'm pretty sure that's what's on the cover. I'm pretty sure Legolas is on the second one, and I know Aragorn holding Andoril is on the third one. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure Legolas is on my second one. But mine are the trade paperbacks. They're not the mass market.
Oh, okay, well, that's probably why.
They're the big ones.
Yeah.
Which, again, that's a souvenir, because if I'm going to read, I would rather read the mass market size, because the big ones are kind of awkward.
Yeah, they don't fit in a bag as easy.
Yeah. And I hate hardbacks. I'm trying to slowly replace all of my hardbacks with paperbacks. I don't have many left. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have a few that I won't get rid of, like my first edition, first printing of Belgarath the Sorcerer. That ain't going nowhere. I found that in a used bookstore for $10. Needless to say.
Right.
It came home with me. And my two first edition, first printing hardbacks I have of, I have the last two Harry Potter books that are first edition, first printings. And I have a first edition, I don't know if it's first printing or not, I know it's a first edition of a book called Glenraven by Marion Zimmer Bradley and Holly Lyle, which is a really good book. It's also not in print anymore, I don't think. So I have it. And then I have a couple of Piers Anthony books that are first editions. But that's really the only ones I want to keep as far as hardbacks go. But, oh, one last one that I wanted to mention, book covers that I like, is the Dragonlance series by Margaret Weiss and Tracy Hickman. Now, the original Dragonlance Chronicles, the covers when TSR actually owned it, those were okay. They were kind of a similar style to the Lord of the Rings I was talking about, a solid color with just a square picture on the front. But the newer version covers, they actually, you know, are a lot, they're really, really pretty. They have, you know, artwork by a different author, and they've actually wrapped, or author, artist, and they've wrapped the artwork around the cover. It's like a big full picture if you hold it up, you know. They're really, really, really pretty. I like those. I don't remember who the artist is. I don't know that I've ever actually looked. I know it's not Don Mayett. But, you know, there's a lot of fantasy authors out there, and it could be any number of them.
Right.
But I think the newer covers, and I'm kind of sad, though. I mean, I had the original Chronicles. I had the old covers, all of them, which, you know, Wizards of the Coast owns it now. They're the ones that publish them. But when it was TSR, you know, those versions are hard to find now. And I had all of them, and I lost one of them, and I was so upset. So now my set doesn't match.
Uh-oh. Well,
and that bugs me.
Yeah, that's one of the things that drives you nuts.
And it really annoys me when publishers are like, oh, we're going to publish these two in a typical mass market paperback, and then we're going to do book three in this mass market paperback that's an inch taller than these. I'm like, no, you can't do that because then my set doesn't match.
Yeah, I've had that problem with a couple. I don't know if I've had it with a specific series, but I've had it with individual books where my bookshelf ends up being all cattywamps.
It's like, how? I can't shelve this.
Yeah.
Come on. Because, you know, my bookshelf that me and my dad built is, the shelves are spaced for a typical mass market paperback. There's just enough room above the book to get your finger in there and pull the book out. I mean, I specifically built it to be that size. So if I get something in one of these series that's on that shelf that is taller, it's not going to fit. And that's just really going to annoy me. For the most part, though, the ones that have done that are the, like, my Kathy Reich's books and my Patricia Cornwell books, which are on a different shelf because they're in the spare bedroom because that's the stuff that me and my mom both read, so I've got it separated.
Okay.
So that she doesn't have to come all the way in my room to get one of them if she wants to read it. So those are in the spare bedroom. And, you know, it's hard to shelve those because it's like I'll have 1, 2, 3, and then this tall one, and then 4, 5, and 6 are normal, and then another tall one, and I'm like, no! Stop it! I want to stab them when they do that. And when they, you know, change the style of the covers halfway through a series.
Yeah, I've had a couple of series that have done that too.
I'm like, really? Can we not be consistent? Like, you know, you'll do the first... The worst offender is the Eve Dallas series by J.D. Robb. Like, her older books, are the covers are a certain style, and then after, like, the first 10, they change the... It's like every 10 books, they change the style of the covers. I'm like, would you stop doing that? Because then they don't all match. And, like, the older ones, you can't buy new anymore. So you can't buy, you can't even buy them that match the newer ones. It just really just gets my goat.
Well, we have been talking about book covers for an exceptionally long amount of time.
Really have.
Which is funny considering the fact that I didn't know if we would have as much to say about this topic. But apparently...
Look, I have opinions about everything.
We have a lot to say about this topic. So, anyway, I think we should probably wrap it up for tonight.
Probably.
So, we'd like to know, you know, if any of our listeners have some favorite cover art or some, you know, favorite artists that do a lot with books, or, you know, if you have the same kind of gripes that Jess has about their books being all the same size. I have that one, too. I can't get on your case too much about that. But, anyway, if you would like to... Let us know what some of your favorites are. You can contact us in a multitude of ways. The first way would be by email, and our email address is bibliophiles.podcast@gmail.com. You can also find us on Twitter, and our Twitter is @BibAnonPodcast, and you can follow us over there, too. Sometimes we'll get on there and talk about the books we're reading, or I will sometimes link some of my blog entries over there, some of my book reviews, and, you know, we follow a lot of authors, and if they're saying anything interesting or funny, we'll retweet it, so come and follow us on Twitter, because we have a lot of fun over there.
We could just, you know, retweet everything Maureen Johnson posts.
Yeah.
Because she's hilarious.
She is, and she's on her way to my state.
I still think you should go.
I think I'm going to. She's doing a book signing, and it's... about an hour and a half drive away from my house. So I think I'm going to go and say hi because I love her. She's so funny and her new book is out now and I really want it. So getting a signed copy would be awesome.
Yes, it would. And then you can tweet about it from the podcast account and maybe she'll see it and, you know,
she can retweet
us.
That would be cool.
That would be awesome.
Okay.
Look, I'm a podcaster. We talk about you all the time. I think you're awesome.
Anyway, so yeah, come follow us on Twitter. You can also follow us at the Malorian Tavern website, and that address is www.maltavern.com.
We're over there usually starting... Actually, that's another one of those things that I've kind of let slide by the wayside. I go over there and I look, I just haven't posted anything lately.
Yeah.
Because I've had my head in Lord of the Rings so much lately. You just don't even know. It's so much different playing when I actually have someone I know who's playing as well.
And that would be me.
Yes, because for the longest on the other server, it's like every time I was on, there was no one in my kin online. Nobody to help me with the stuff I needed help with. And I'm just like, huh, you know. And then I get you on Imla Address, and I get started on Imla Address, and now it's like, okay, look, I'm actually making something of this, you know. My characters are making lots of progress with their crafting, especially.
All right, so here's a question. For next week's show, should we try to discuss beautiful creatures?
Yes, because, you know...
will that kick you in the butt enough?
Yes, that will force me to finish it.
Now I just have to try and find it. I say this, but I don't even have a copy of the book. Well, I guess I can always get it on Kindle if I can't get a hard copy. So, okay, so we'll decide that right now. Next week, we will be talking about beautiful creatures.
I'm over halfway done with it, so...
Now, who's the author?
Cami Garcia and Margaret Stoll.
Okay. So that is our topic for next week, everybody.
I'm on page 340 of... Oh, wait, that's a preview of the next book. That doesn't count in the pages. I'm on page 340 of 563, so I'm over halfway done with it.
Oh, you can finish that in a week.
I can finish that in a day if I really just sat down and read it.
Well, then you need to.
Well, if we're going to discuss it next week, I have to.
We are discussing it next week. It has so been decided.
Okay, I will have to finish that. I will make a point to finish that.
So, until next time, we'll be reading Beautiful Creatures.
All right. See you guys then.
Alrighty. Bye.
Bye.